Hello, friends, and welcome to the March 9th edition of Weekly Witness, Texas Impact's weekly opportunity for mainstream Texans of faith to learn about policy issues here in our great state and have a conversation about how you can engage in that process. My name is Scott Atnip, your host and Texas Impact's Director of Public Witness, and we have an exciting episode for you today as we welcome Bonnie Bruce to the program. Bonnie's the founder of Mesquite Strategies, an Austin-based lobby practice that brings her 24 years of experience in and around the Texas Capitol to the program to talk with us about the Texas primary election results. We'll also be joined by Texas Impact Foundation Board President Beaman Floyd to talk about what the primary election results can tell us. On this week's watch list, Josh updates us about legislative hearings happening this week, because in the midst of election season, governing is still happening. And to kick us off, we'll begin with a weekly word from Reverend George Mason from Wilshire Baptist Church in Dallas. But before we get to the program, I want to share a couple of quick thoughts at the top. First, thanks to all who've reached out in response to our recent episodes. We love your comments, questions, and suggestions. We'd love to hear from you. I'll be looking for your emails at scott@texasimpact.org. And help us out by subscribing, sharing, and inviting a friend to listen. Y'all, we're just not getting a break, are we? Last week, we talked about Ukraine and the state of Texas trying to separate trans kids from their parents. This week, we can add national fears about gas prices and growing concern about how Texas leaders are alienating major businesses like American Airlines that drive our state's economy, which is the eighth largest economy in the world. Every day, it seems like there's a new failure in the public policy realm. I so get being exhausted by it all. Our small group at church was planning on starting a new Lenten series on systemic racism last weekend, but at the last minute, we couldn't face any more pain and decided it would just be a better course of action to go and drown our sorrows at a local restaurant. And for the moment, that was probably the wise choice. What's happening in the world and right here in Texas is not just unacceptable, it's unimaginable to folks like me, who grew up proud to be a native of a state whose name means friendship. Of course, we want to hide from what we see unfolding. But the messes that are concerning us are public policy failures, which means that there are public policy solutions, which means that our faith both calls and equips us to lead in this time. Our faith calls us to watch enough news to understand what's happening, but not so much that we lose heart. Our faith calls us to listen to our neighbors, but not to lose our own voice. Our faith calls us to engage our elected representatives about the policy failures in Texas, but not to alienate those with whom we disagree. Our faith traditions equip us to bring our values into the public square and to discern ways forward that honor our communities and our state. I'm reminded in this moment of the stories, from my own faith tradition and others, of small groups of people who patiently, stubbornly, bravely worked to bend the arc. Now it's our turn. I'm so grateful for the chance to do this work with you. So with that, here we go. The Weekly Word with Reverend George Mason.
Hello, I'm George Mason, senior pastor of Wilshire Baptist Church in Dallas and president of Faith Commons. I'm grateful for the opportunity to share a weekly word with you as Texas Impact continues to inspire us and organize us to pursue the common good. I want to offer a variation on a phrase that I think we need to consider in our time. What happens here doesn't stay here. You know, I think it's Las Vegas who uses the phrase, what happens here stays here. But the truth is more often what I had suggested, and that is we live in a hyper-connected world now. And what we've seen with the invasion of Ukraine by Russia is the immediate impact of what is happening in our lives here and in all places around the globe. Oil prices have spiked, and we're paying more than $4 per gallon at the gas tank now. And there are many other consequences, of course, of that to democracy and to religious liberty. And we're seeing in that particular instance what we have witnessed during COVID to be true, with supply chains being broken and slowed, and all sorts of ways in which we recognize the deep connectedness of our world. Martin Luther King Jr. said famously, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. Now, most of the time, I think we hear that negatively, and we recognize that there's a consequence to all of us when injustice is done. But I also want to turn that around and recognize that when we consider the times we live in, any positive action we take can also have positive ripple effects elsewhere. Justice done anywhere can promote justice everywhere because of that notion of being tied together in a single garment of destiny. So one thing happened recently I'd like to share with you in that respect. In our church, just days after the invasion of Ukraine, we had one of our members conduct a choral ensemble. Mike Capps, a friend of mine in the church, is also a composer and musician, and he had chosen a piece several weeks earlier for his choral ensemble to sing in worship by the Russian composer Sergei Rachmaninoff. The piece was titled Morning Prayer, and it comes from a portion of his work called Six Psalms in English. It's actually taken from the Orthodox Christian prayer book, and it goes like this simply, glory to thee, glory to thee, glory to thee, God, glory to thee. We bless thee, O God in the highest, Lord of mercy, both now and unto ages. Amen. Well, Mike was concerned about the timing of celebrating a Russian composer in the immediate aftermath of Russia's invasion. And so he introduced the piece to us by saying, even as war and fear have come to their land, every morning it's not unlikely that Orthodox Ukrainian believers will reach for their prayer book and recite the morning prayer, which contains these very opening lines, glory to thee, O God, glory to thee, three times. This morning we sing it in solidarity with our brothers and sisters and offer it as a prayer on their behalf. Well, it was a touching moment, and in the congregation that morning was a doctor in our church, and she had been on medical missions work in Bulgaria years ago and had close ties to people there still. And she immediately went home, found the YouTube link, and emailed this musical offering to a lawyer friend in Sofia, Bulgaria. He works with Ukrainians on religious liberty issues, and some of them were in besieged settings in that country, which was already under missile fire. He was able to send it to them, and they were able to receive it and hear it as an act of grace and comfort from people they didn't know halfway across the globe. And all of this took place just within hours of that simple exercise in a Baptist church in worship. Think globally, act locally. That's the phrase we often hear, and it's all the more important in our connected world. We sometimes don't realize that the effects of what we do when we advocate for policy in Texas on many of the issues we care about will have great effects beyond our state and beyond even our country. So consider the positive effects of our working together and doing what we can to live in solidarity with one another, to consider the cause of those who are most vulnerable in our society, and we'll act together in ways that then the Spirit of God can use unpredictably to us to bring comfort and security in ways we can't even imagine. Thanks very much for all you do, Texas Impact.
This week's episode of Weekly Witness was brought to you by Methodist Healthcare Ministries of South Texas and the COVID Collaborative.
Joining us for today's conversation is Bonnie Bruce, founder of Mesquite Strategies, a new lobby practice in Austin, Texas. Bonnie's amazing. We've had her speak to many Texas Impact events in the past. She has 24 years of experience in the Texas Capitol and in the Texas policy scene. And so, Bonnie, we're excited for the conversation today. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Scott. That's very kind of you.
So last week, we had primary elections in Texas, and those were the first set of elections, or the first set of primary elections anyway, after redistricting. So we know that this is expected to make districts less competitive in the general, but tell us the impact of redistricting. How does that impact primary elections, and if those expectations were actually borne out during the elections last week?
Of course, everybody talks about the impact in the general election and the fact that, you know, we have seats that have flipped from Democrat districts to Republican districts like Senate District 10. But there were impacts in the primary. For example, many people not know this, but the lieutenant governor specifically drew his Senate map to be able to get rid of some of his more moderate Republican senators and to bring in more conservative voices. Specifically in Senate District 31, he got rid of Senator Seliger, which has been a longtime bane for him as a moderate from West Texas. And coming in is Kevin Sparks, who is an oil man who is very, very conservative, more aligned with Lieutenant Governor. I think also you see some things like in El Paso, there was a pairing between two incumbent Democrats. Originally, Representative Ordaz Perez, a female Hispanic from El Paso, a Democrat, was paired with Representative Lena Ortega, another Hispanic female in El Paso. She moved to a different district to run against Art Fierro. And the reason why is because during the Democrat walkout of their quorum break for voting rights, where they went to Washington, D.C., Art Fierro actually came back to Texas and came to the House floor. And so she perceived him as more of a weakness. And she ran against him and won handily. That doesn't mean that there is one less Democrat, because that district was moved, that she was drawn out of, was moved to Fort Bend County, where there is a Democrat district there. But what it means is less seniority within the Democrat delegation. And so you see through that some weakening of seniority, possible committee appointments, et cetera. And so while you see the Senate, through no change in partisan makeup, you see them getting philosophically more conservative. In the House, what you see is you see some erosion of Democrat power, even through primaries.
So we've been talking about the impact of Senate Bill 1 for what seems like forever. And there was a lot of concern that voters would have a tougher time participating this year because of the voting bill that was passed last year. So there were concerns about specific provisions that impacted mail-in ballots and voter assistance. Mm-hmm. Is there any data coming out of the primaries to show us if and how these new restrictions impacted voting? And should it still be top of mind heading into the runoffs?
So the final numbers are not in completely. They haven't been canvassed for the election, and we don't know what the final rejection number was for our mail-in ballots. We did see very, very early on during early voting that mail-in ballots had a rejection rate from anywhere from 8% to as high as 30%. Our election clerks worked with those voters to try and get those numbers down, and they did come down, but you saw a lot of confusion among elderly, among disabled voters who typically vote by mail. Now they have to fill out their their ballot and put their identification information on the ballot as well as the envelope, and some people missed one or the other. You also didn't see candidates being able to mail applications for the absentee ballot to their constituents, which a lot of people were used to. My octogenarian mother, who actually votes in the Republican primary, she kept asking me, I haven't received my ballot. And I was like, your ballot? You haven't received your ballot? What are you? And I realized she was used to candidates mailing her her application for absentee ballot. And I had to instruct her how to get her ballot application in and to be able to receive her absentee ballot. And then even once she sent in her ballot, I mean, I consider myself a very informed individual when it comes to these things. I worked with my mother, but she still, even after she sent in her absentee ballot, she was afraid that she hadn't properly filled it out. And you see with people who assist voters with their ballots, you know, I was helping my mother, but there are people who helped people who are handicapped, and there are criminal penalties now for these individuals for what's maybe perceived as fraud, for helping them. So there's a lot of nervousness, and people are left kind of on their own to try to navigate and find their way to the ballot and to have their voices heard, which has definitely been an impact.
Yeah, and something we'll certainly be talking about as more data comes in. We were just talking about that this morning in the staff meeting. One of the things that we've talked about during this election series we just had on Weekly Witness is that, you know, 90 to 95% of races in Texas, especially after a redistricting year, are decided in primary elections where kind of the fewest number of people participate. So any idea yet on what turnout looked like and how does it compare with previous years?
Yeah. There are very, very few swing seats now after this last redistricting. And so a lot of the people that we are going to see in the legislature were decided in March or are going to be decided at the May 24th runoff. Combined turnout for both the Republican and Democrat primaries was 17.4% of registered voters. That's one in five. That's the highest midterm election turnout in Texas since 1994, which, by the way, was the last time a Democrat was elected to statewide office. The turnout was very lopsided, however. Republican turnout represented 11.3% of registered voters, whereas Democrat turnout was 6.8%. Republican turnout was the second highest percentage for a midterm election, and turnout in Republican primaries more than doubled in 31 counties, mostly in South and West Texas. One of the most dramatic increases was in Starr County, where 15 people voted in the Republican primary in 2018 compared to 1,089 this year. Wow. That was probably driven by the fact that Democrat Representative Ryan Guillen, his district was drawn to be a much more Republican district. He picked up 10 counties and he switched parties and had to, for the first time, run in a Republican primary. And so he lost a lot of his Democrat base, and he lots of money came pouring into that race from the speaker, from lieutenant governor. President Trump endorsed this brand new Republican in this race. And it really drove up the primary turnout in those counties. Statewide, the number of Democratic votes eclipsed 1 million for the fourth straight primary election. However, their turnout in the governor's race actually fell slightly from the 2018 race. But improved from the previous three gubernatorial elections. Unfortunately, what we have is the number of registered voters that didn't ultimately vote was 14.2 million, breaking the previous record in 2018 by 1.5 million. Another 2 million people in Texas were eligible to be registered voters, but didn't vote at all. So that means between those two, people who are eligible to vote but didn't register, or registered voters who ultimately didn't cast a vote, 16 million people did not participate in our elections. And so what we're seeing is that, you know, yes, we had record turnout in Republican primaries. Yes, we had tremendous turnout in Democratic primaries. But we are still a very apathetic state when it comes to getting to the polls.
And I assume that 16 million number will increase dramatically with the runoffs coming up in May, right?
Of course. You know, as people get worn out on elections, you know, you're going to have the Republican runoff. I mean, the primaries, you're going to have the May municipal elections, and then you're going to have the runoff for the primaries. And in between there, if you happen to live in particular districts, there's going to be special elections for House District 38. There's going to be a special election for House District 147. And we presume there's going to be a special election in there at some point for Representative Chris Patty, who just recently resigned the day after the election. And so the voters are going to have to vote multiple times before the November election. And of course, they all say, but I already voted.
Right. Several times, in fact. Yeah. So anything in particular you're watching as we move toward the May runoff election?
So, yes, I was very interested in money that was being poured into a brand new PAC called Defend Texas Liberty, which is money that is coming from Tim Dunn and the Wilkes brothers out of West Texas. These are individuals that have been known to fund conservative organizations and races. They are the individuals who are behind Empower Texans, a lot of money from TPPF. They used to fund their involvement in campaigns through Empower Texan PAC, but they folded that this election cycle, and a brand new PAC was opened up, Defend Texas Liberty, and it's run by former Representative Jonathan Sticklin. And they poured millions of dollars into the Don Huffines race, but they also poured money into over a dozen candidates for the Texas legislature. Several of those candidates, like Shelley Luther against Representative Reggie Smith, failed to win their primary election, but they managed to have four of their candidates get into the runoffs, three in open races and one against Representative Stephanie Click, chairwoman for the House Committee on Public Health. As we talked about, the lieutenant governor is embracing more conservative voices in the Senate. The speaker is actually trying to hold on to a conservative, not that conservative of a majority in his house. He has been helping his incumbents fend off those Defend Texas Liberty challengers and has for a large portion been very, very successful in defending his incumbents. But four wins is a lot within the Republican caucus to be able to push some of their agendas, like the rules changes where they don't want any Democrat chairs. They believe that all majority, the majority party should hold all of the committee chairs. Things like they want a constitutional amendment to lower the quorum requirements for the House so that the Democrats can't break quorum by leaving because they want to lower it to a simple majority, which they have well over that in the Republican majority. So yeah, those are definitely races that I'm looking for, because it'll definitely change the philosophical bend and potentially the rules of the House and whether or not the minority has much of a vote or voice at all.
So it's really important that listeners check to see which races will be on the ballot in their community leading up to the May election and get involved there. Were there any other top line takeaways that that you think listeners should be aware of from the first set of primary elections?
Well, depending on if you're in the Republican or the Democrat primary, I mean, obviously you need to be aware of what's on your ballot. Texas has closed primaries, which means if you you voted in the Democrat primary, you can't switch over and vote in the Republican runoffs and vice versa. There are some Democrat runoffs throughout the state. A big one that pops into my head is House District 147 to replace Representative Coleman. Of course, on the Republican side, there's a couple of runoffs on the top of the ticket that I will be interested in. But as far as what I took away from Election Day and those primaries, and I think that it's important to realize that looking at the top of the ticket, the Democrat turnout was about a third of the total votes cast in some of these statewide elections. So if there is going to be any real challenge of some of our statewide elected officials in the general election, the appeal to independent voters, the appeal to people who don't vote in the primaries is really going to have to be aggressive. This is a Republican state. It is still a Republican state. They hold all of the statewide elected officials, and their vote share in the primaries between people who came out to vote in the Republican base versus the Democrat base is really, really strong. That's something that looking down ballot, looking at the general election race, the race for governor, I mean, both Abbott and Beto O'Rourke came out with ads the day after the election. And I thought, oh my God, we have more than 200 days before the general election. You guys are going to wear me out
already. Yeah.
But, that they've got to. They've got to be able to fight for those independent votes, because the Republicans have a stronghold on their base. And so the only hope that Democrats have to make those races competitive is to be able to persuade those independent voters.
So shifting gears a little bit, in part because I know you've worked in and around the Capitol for so long. We're always, and we talked earlier, not an age thing. You've been doing it since you were young, right?
In vitro.
Right. We're always telling our folks to meet with their legislative offices to build those relationships. What happens in those offices between the primary and the general elections? What's the best way to engage with staffers during this period? And does that change if the member's retiring?
So now is definitely the time to go talk to your legislature. If you have a relationship with your local elected staff, if you know their district administrator, et cetera, and you have a great relationship with them, that is a leg up for you come session. You don't have to explain who you are. You don't have to explain what your issues are. You can walk in and you can talk to them and they're like, oh, hey, Bonnie, how are you?
Right.
I love donuts. If you take donuts to the district office, let me tell you what, the district office never gets any lobby love. And so if you as a constituent just walk in and just say, hey, I wanted to introduce myself. I wanted to say thank you for your service. I wanted to tell you the kind of the issues that were important to me. I promise you they will remember you because they don't get a lot of walk-in traffic.
Right.
This is a great time to go introduce yourself. It's also a good time to go meet with legislators home. They're in their district. This is when they have a lot of time. And it is always easier to go build that relationship when you have time. I tell people all the time, if you are having a barbecue in your backyard and you run out of propane gas, are you going to go to your next door neighbor that you go to church with and that you have kids in the same school and that you go hang out with all the time? Or are you going to go ask the neighbor that just moved in, that you don't know, that you've never run into before, you're not even sure if they're home? You're going to go with the person that you have a relationship with. And so if you have a relationship built up during the interim, they understand who you are when you call them, and they are more likely to take your call during session. And so it's important to build those relationships up. Does it change if somebody is leaving office? These people are still elected officials for a year. So number one, they can still help you if you have constituent issues, which I strongly encourage people to understand and have that connection. If they need something from the state, to call their legislature, never to be shy about that. But also, if a outgoing legislator has a good relationship with the incoming legislator, then they may end up transferring their district staff. The district staff may end up working for both legislators. They may pass on legislative ideas from one, the outgoing, to the incoming. Lastly, that legislator is still going to be in office for interim charges, for interim studies. They will have votes and impacts on what is recommended to the following legislator. And so are they as powerful necessarily as somebody who is going to be there for the 88th legislature. No. But your relationship with them, especially if they have a good relationship with the incoming legislator, is really important.
I love that. You might have seen me laughing in the middle of your answer because we had Senator Carol Alvarado on a couple of weeks ago, and you mentioned donuts. We challenged our listeners to bring cookies or baked goods to legislative offices, and she suggested that her office liked healthy snacks. And so,
that is a challenge. Bananas. Apples, fruit baskets.
Donuts are great, but the homework assignment is to know what your office likes in terms of snacks. And
well, and just because the senator likes healthy snacks doesn't necessarily mean that her staff does.
B said the same thing. Bonnie, that was all really great advice. Any other advice you'd like to leave listeners with or closing thoughts today?
You know, as we move toward the primary runoffs and the general election, if your listeners for whatever reason, which I can't imagine they would if they're listening to this podcast, but if for whatever reason they are not already registered to vote, they can still register to vote for the runoff up until April 25th, and they can register to vote in the general election up to October 4th. You can find some great information on vote411.org, which is the League of Women Voters website. Which will tell you all of your deadlines for Texas. It'll tell you how to apply for a absentee ballot. It'll tell you, you know, where to go vote. If you know that you're going to be an absentee ballot voter, I would get familiar with the requirements of applying for your ballot and what the ID requirements are on your ballot and on your envelope. See whether or not your county has a way for you to track your absentee ballot so that you feel comfortable in knowing that it's been accepted. And so just be prepared. We are in a situation where things have changed for Republicans and Democrats. And it's something that voters who are disabled and elderly are having a hard adjustment to. And so I would just really encourage everybody to learn what the new rules are and to make sure that your voice is heard.
Bonnie, really appreciate the conversation. Thank you so much for the time today, and thanks for all you do.
Thank you so much for inviting me, Scott. I appreciate it.
And I bet you can guess who's joining us for this week's weekly watch list. Josh Houston, in fact. Josh, it was election week last week, right?
It was.
And we've been talking elections during this episode. But guess what, friends? There's a lot going on in the world of public policy in Texas that's not election related. So, Josh, what are you watching this week?
Yeah, so we have the first two Senate hearings, which are the first hearings we've had since they were in special session months ago. And, you know, that's not unusual for hearings to start right after the primary. What is rather unusual is that we still do not have any interim charges. Interim charges are a thing that usually the presiding officers of both chambers put out and their instructions to study certain policy areas. And the lack of them, the lack of them made sure that they weren't inserted into the primaries. But the lack of them also evidences a complete sublimation of the normal policy process to state politics.
And so what's on the docket? What are you watching?
Yeah, so there's going to be two, and they're both in the Senate. There is the Senate Committee on Border Security, and then the Senate on Tuesday and on Wednesday, the Senate Committee on Business and Commerce is going to meet to talk about the grid. And on the agenda, the agendas are rather broad. It's going to be mostly an overview in both committees. But, you know, nothing really happens in the Senate without the lieutenant governor's permission. So, historically, in the last half decade, the hearings in the Senate have been largely theater. So I'll be watching for theatrics.
All right. And I assume this is just an FYI for folks right now. Is there anything people should be paying attention to?
Yeah, Scott, the things I'll be listening for over on the border security side. In the primary, every Republican ran on border security. I'll be interested to see how the Russian invasion of Ukraine, if and how it affects that conversation. You had the governor tweet out kind of right after CPAC, a talking point that came out of CPAC, which was he wishes the president would care more about the southern border the way he seems to care about the Ukrainian border. Not quite analogous. And then he tweeted
those
out.
Those are exactly the same right now.
Yeah. I mean, but that was an ultra right wing talking point that came out of CPAC that got parroted. And then in that same tweet, mentioned that 15 individuals from the country of China and 15 individuals from the country of Russia were caught and apprehended at the southern border. And he's, you know, wanted to get to the bottom of it. And what was not mentioned was, okay, so if you get to the bottom of it, and it turns out that these are people who are being persecuted for their political beliefs, are you going to then advocate for their asylum, as is the legal processes under asylum? None of that conversation. And then I bring this up because we mentioned it last week and again this week. Reuters put out a story about how Russians and Ukrainians are buying cheap cars in Mexico and driving across the border because they have a better process. I mean, they have the money to be able to do that, and then they have generally better outcomes when they try to drive across that way. So, again, that's a thing we're going to be dealing with out of this crisis on the other side of the world. One of many things we'll be dealing with. I'll be interested to see how the Senate handles it. If there's any mention of it, it could just be silence. And that's interesting too, if they're taking a wait and see approach, but if there's any dissonance with the governor or if they're in lockstep with the governor. Over on the Business and Commerce Committee, where they're talking about the electric grid, I'll be listening for the, you know, market design of the electric grid is a huge giant topic. So I'll be interested in what they say with regards to regulation. They've been in a rhetorical false dichotomy for years that no regulation is good and any regulation is bad, and that's just not true. It's a false binary. You can have good and bad regulations and good and bad no regulations. So they've been in that dichotomy for a long time. I'll also be listening to anything regarding generation sources. In other words, where we get our power from. Diversity helps absorb shocks in the market. Do they get real anti-renewable, which is more of an ideological position than a fact-based position? Texas is, of course, very gas-heavy in our generation, and I'll be interested to see if there's any conversation about the price of gas, because while high oil prices are good for Texas, gas and oil are not necessarily in the same marketplace, it'll be interesting to see what people prognosticate the forecast is for gas, which is not the same as it is for oil, but we're already feeling the shock with oil. So again, oil does not affect electric rates. We do not burn oil to create fossil fuels by and large. We do burn gas to create electric. And so the price of gas will affect electric rates, and that's interesting. And then I'll also be listening for the political. Is there any tension that arises between the governor and the Senate? Is there any tension that arises between the House and the Senate with regard to the grid? And, you know, in a time where just no one can hear nuance or think in nuance anymore, we're going to have a policy conversation about a policy area that requires nuance and balance, which is the electric grid. And can they do that?
I think this is an important reminder that the policy work that will guide the next legislative session is starting now. And so it's important to be paying attention. Thanks for that update today. And we will talk to you again next week.
All right. Thanks, Scott.
Next, I'd like to welcome to the conversation Beaman Floyd. Beaman is the president of the Texas Impact Foundation Board of Directors and a longtime observer of all things inside the Texas Capitol. Beaman, we just talked to Bonnie and we laughed a little bit before we came on. She said she'd been doing this for 24 years in and around the Texas Capitol, and she'd recently had a conversation with somebody where they were able to introduce themselves as two folks who'd been doing this work for more than 50 years between the two of them. And I don't want to ask you how long you've been doing it, but
it's been a while.
It has. Thanks for joining us today. So we're going to be talking about the elections, the primary elections that just took place. And I guess we'll start with what were your top line takeaways from the primary election last week?
Well, I mean, I think the first top lines were numerical. The midterm elections are often sort of a down cycle election. In terms of the gross numbers, almost twice as many people voted in the Republican primary as the Democrat primary, which is a huge part of the analysis of this thing, that Republicans are quite energized in Texas. What people are wondering is whether that's because they had some competitive races at the top of the ticket, which may well be, or whether it represents a 2-to-1 level of interest between Republicans and Democrats in Texas.
Right.
So that's a big one. I think another number that's important to look at is the fact that just prior to the election, when they closed early voting and were doing estimates of the early voting totals, most of the people who are watching that kind of thing thought that the turnout would be way down because early voting was actually quite low. But there was a lot of Election Day voting.
Right.
And so we're not exactly sure what that means. I would theorize, and I think it bears study. If I were starting a study on this thing, my hypothesis would be that people were really worried about the new election laws. And because they were worried about them, they became mistrustful of anything other than the most basic kind of voting, which is, you know, showing up on Election Day, casting your vote, getting your sticker. Then you don't have to worry about all that other stuff that they might have been either reading online or in the press or, God forbid, in non-fact-based social media about what was happening with the vote. So those were two of the big numbers that we were looking at. With regard to the content of the election, you saw a lot of incumbents win. There were lots of ideas before the election that there was going to be some big swing one way or the other with regard to both inter-party politics and intra-party politics, and you really didn't see that. You saw incumbents by and large carry the day, not a whole lot of movement either way. And those people that were supported by the structures in which they live, both in the House and the Senate, tended to do pretty well.
Yes, let's talk about that some, because we talk about elections because it impacts how we're able to work on public policy during the next legislative session.
Sure.
And so is there anything that you were able to take from the House side that will influence how you see the Texas legislature operating in 2023? I know there was a lot of attention paid to many of those houses.
Yeah, I mean, I think that what we saw is that the House is the House. Sometimes we have talked about intra-party politics. I just mentioned it. In the Republican Party, that there are, but those exist in the Democratic Party as well. On the congressional side of the Democratic primary, we saw a whole bunch of progressives running against more conventional Democratic candidates here, and they did not get the progressive wave they were looking for generally in Texas. I think that same held true in the House, in that you didn't see a whole lot of people who got primaried from the right get ousted from the right. You saw essentially those structures and do pretty well. That may, again, there are a lot of different reasons for that, Scott. That may have been, you know, people like their local guy. It may not have had anything to do with the great party struggles at all. It may have had to do with this person has been our person. He or she is in our community and represents our district well, the end. So you would have to go race by race to try to understand it. But by and large, we will get a pretty familiar, notwithstanding the fact that a lot of incumbents left and we'll have a lot of new faces, in other ways, we'll get both a House and a Senate with which we're pretty familiar, likely, in the next legislative session.
Yeah, so you just mentioned the Senate, saying it'd be relatively familiar. Were there any races that would indicate changes of any sort going into next legislative session there?
Not too many. I think that the Senate will be a pretty familiar Senate, and certainly the Lieutenant Governor made a very, very strong showing in his primary. He got more than 70% of the vote and is really doing well. I thought that with his constituency, I thought it was pretty interesting that in the Democratic primary for Lieutenant Governor, there is going to be a runoff, that Mike Collier, who's been in the race for a long time and has invested a lot in the race, did not get a clear majority. And that's if I were in that campaign, I would be somewhat worried about that, in that I don't think that that Mr. Collier has gained a lot of name recognition, even in his own party. At this point, it was sort of a catch-all vote, I felt like, in that primary race. And so if they're going to have to slug it out, the two remaining candidates are going to have to slug it out in the Democratic primary, and then there's going to be a pretty big job of getting your name ID up for the general election. And if you put that together with the turnout issues in the Republican and the Democratic primaries, if I were in the lieutenant governor's campaign right now, I'd be feeling pretty good for sure.
I assume on the Republican side, the attorney general race is the one to watch.
It is.
For me.
It is. It's interesting. It's interesting that the sitting attorney general did very well, really well, and in terms of the, I think in some measure beating expectations from a lot of people who are watching that race. And I think it's also important to notice that Judge Guzman and Louis Gohmert were the people who have dropped out of that race, and they were pretty close to even in votes, just a few percentage points different. And it is pretty likely that Congressman Gohmert's people are going to go more toward Paxton, and that Ms. Guzman's people would maybe go more towards Commissioner Bush. It's hard to tell, but it looks pretty good for Attorney General Paxton at this point, I think.
Anything else you're watching down ballot for the May runoffs?
No, I mean, I think it's going to settle out pretty quickly with regard to both the House and the Senate. There are a few down ballot races that we're watching, but nothing that really moves the needle very much in either the House or the Senate. What's really going to be interesting is the full court press that everybody runs from now until the general election. And what's going to be extremely interesting, at least to me, as a policy guy, not an election guy. And let me make that clear. I'm both in terms of what I do for my work and my position with the Texas Impact Foundation. We're not really election people. We're really interested in policy making. We have to watch elections to understand how we're going to make policy. But what I'm really interested in seeing in the run to the general election is whether or not there's a lot of outside resources put into Texas. And I'm specifically curious to see whether the primary numbers are going to reduce the desire of outside Democratic money to come into the state to try to bolster and run broad Democratic races, whether there's going to be a focus on Beto O'Rourke, who has very strong name ID and won his primary handily, but is fighting an uphill battle if you look at the numbers in the primary. So it's all of it is to say, I think we're going to be looking at a Texas with which we're pretty familiar in terms of getting in there and starting to do the policy work that we need to do. So we need to get busy and start doing it.
So obviously we'll see how this holds. We have May elections, we have November elections. We'll talk again in November and revisit the conversation we're currently having. But any advice for people who are interested in doing that policy work? What should they be doing right now to begin laying the foundation for January 2023 when the legislature comes back?
Go get to know your legislator in your local district. That's an easy one. That was a softball, Scott.
What do those conversations look like at this point in the process? What would you be talking to them about besides building that relationship?
Those conversations look like going to your to the office of your state representative in district, not at the Capitol, but where y'all live, and saying, listen, I'm interested in public policy. I'm one of your constituents. I'm a member of the community. I'm involved in your community, and I'm involved with some policy making bodies, including Texas Impact at the state level. And I just wanted to introduce myself and let you know I will likely be calling on you. And if you have anything you need or want from me, let me know. And that's that sounds like nothing, but it's really something. It's a way for people to get to know a little something about the district staff. It's a way for people to get on the radar. I mean, a lot of the people that are our members or our watchers probably already know something about their state legislator. Go in there and just it's putting them on notice in the most polite and constructive way. That you're going to be somebody who's going to be communicating with them during the legislative session, and then work from there. That's like the homework for this week, and then you know, pay attention to the, if you're interested in us, pay attention to the materials we put out. If you're interested in other things, get yourself as educated as you can on policy issues, and start doing a steady diet, which I would kind of call every other month, unless something acute is happening. But in terms of the general backgrounders that you want to do, every other month, touching base with the office and say, look, I just wanted to give you this, or make you aware that we're working on this, or we're moving toward legislation of a certain kind. So that way, when you start showing up with bills in the fall or against bills in the spring, they know who you are. They know what you're, they're not surprised by you. They have a sense of your courtesy and professionalism, which is really, really important, because they're always worried about crazy people walking through the door. Don't be a crazy person, by the way. That's important.
Always good advice.
Always good advice. Yeah. That, number one, don't be a crazy person. You know, be constructive and be somebody who's, if you're a good community constituent, what you're doing is helping them make better votes. And so you're helping them. And I think that that's really an important sort of tone to convey to members. And you don't do that with one meeting on one issue when you're asking them for something. You do that in a series of meetings when you're developing a reasonable bond of trust. Think of yourself as a counselor. You wouldn't walk into somebody and say, hey, I'm a counselor, here's what you need to do, and goodbye. You have to do some listening, and you have to do some relationship building, and you have to do some trust building, and then you get to start having those critical conversations.
So that is the homework for everybody, to start building the relationship with their elected representatives. And I would note that there are some members who've already won, right? They won their primary. They don't have anybody in the general. And probably spend extra time doing the policy work with those folks. But any advice or maybe any closing thoughts for people who are in competitive, and there aren't a ton of them, but people who are in competitive races still in the runoff or leading up to the general election, do we need to approach those a little differently than the ones who've already won?
Well, sure. I mean, I think that the understand that when you walk into that office, the first thing they're going to ask you, likely, which they should, is, can I rely on you? Can I rely on you voting? Will you support me? Yep. And you have to have that, preview that question and decide how you want to answer it before you walk into the office, because you don't want to be taken by surprise or say, I'll get back to you on that. You tell them what you really think. And if what you really think is, well, I'm undecided on the way I'm going to vote, but that doesn't mean I shouldn't talk to you as a sitting member about policy issues. You're my representative here and now. That's a valid answer. If you're ready to say yes, support you. You know, that's the easy part. Now let's talk about policy. That's another thing. I think the other thing, and this is a giant meta thing, Scott. Holding people accountable for the stuff they say. It's a big deal. And some of our listeners may have heard me say before, one of the good question to ask any candidate for office is, what do you consider to be the limits of your authority? You know, what can't you work on for me? Because so many times you have folks that will talk about, you know, I'm going to close the borders. Really? You're a state representative. I thought that was a federal deal. I mean, that's an easy one, right? We talk about that one all the time. But there are lots of other things that people are talking about or promising to do or refusing to do that is their job. They got to know what their job is. And I think it's important for you as a uninformed citizen to be able to say, look, this is what your job is. And I know what it is, and I want you to know what it is. And then we can have an intelligent conversation about what you may or may not do in the work. So holding people accountable for their vision of what the job is, holding people accountable for those things that they say. Constituent stuff is about learning and then supporting and then holding accountable. And you have to be able to do all three of those things to ultimately formulate a good legislative branch of government that works on policy the right way and produces good policy. And put them on notice. Yeah.
All right. Any closing thoughts for today?
No, stay involved. I guess, yes, stay involved. Stay involved. We have often said that democracy is a ministry of presence. The state is run by the people who show up. And so y'all really need to show up. And again, a large percentage of you, like 149 out of 150 of you for the House, 180 out of 181 of you, live closer to your state representatives and senators than I do. And so you're closer than me. You mean more to them than I do. Exercise that local option to go in and talk with them in their districts. It's important.
It is important. And Beaman, I really appreciate the time today. Thanks for the time and thanks for the work you do for Better Texas every day. Appreciate it.
You bet. Appreciate it, Scott. Thanks.
I want to thank our guests today, Reverend George Mason, Bonnie Bruce, Josh Houston, and Beaman Floyd. But I especially want to thank you for tuning in. To reiterate what I said at the top, there's a lot going on in the world right now. It can be exhausting, but that means that more than ever, Texans of faith are needed to bring voices of sanity to the political discourse. I hope you'll share this episode with your friends who might need to hear it, and spend some time thinking about how you will engage with your elected representatives to create positive change in the world around you. Texans of faith are called to take our responsibility seriously, to care for our neighbors, whether here or across the globe. So let's spend some time this week reaching out to our friends and inviting them on this journey with us. The time to act is now. And with that, it's time to draw this episode to a close. If you stayed with us this long, you must have enjoyed the content, so hope you'll share it with your friends and congregations and leave us a rating or review. That way, even more of your friends can find us and join in the movement for justice in Texas. And there's a lot going on, so keep an eye on Texas Impact social media for upcoming announcements, or email me at scott@texasimpact.org with questions. And remember, if you appreciate Texas Impact and the Weekly Witness community, please make sure that you and your congregation are members of Texas Impact by going to texasimpact.org. Friends, these are wild times, and 2022 is an important year for democracy. More than ever, the world needs Texans of faith active and engaged. So let's get to work.
Weekly Witness is hosted by Scott Atnett, engineered and produced by David Fasalo. Our executive producer is Bea Moorhead. The opinions expressed on Weekly Witness are those of Texas Impact and our guests and do not necessarily reflect the views of our sponsors. Weekly Witness is a product of Texas Impact, people of faith working for justice. Visit us online at texasimpact.org.